said that in spite of the vows you had made, the glitter of gold turned your head. And while I was trying employment to find, you married another instead. Are you all alone with a memory?
You are listening to WOOPLP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Where'd the old town go? They moved it on north of here in a shopping mall.
Good morning and welcome to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9, or you can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. You can call us here at 614-5553. I'd like to thank my good friend John Cook for writing the original music that you hear on our opening every week called Old Town. He wrote about him and his brother. And also he wrote the original music for our documentary, It's a Dirt Track Life, which will be shown tomorrow at Walker Valley at 3 p.m. So if you're not doing anything coming up, it's free to the public. It's a Dirt Track Life, original music by John Cook. It's an 80-minute documentary about dirt track racing from Dawsonville, Georgia to Gatlinburg, and it just won an award, so we're real proud of that. So come up and see the award-winning It's a Dirt Track Life. Deb, good morning, and tell us about what's going on today.
Good morning. I feel like we've already been here before this morning. We've been on the air at 45 minutes doing a gardening show. We're going to do one again next week. I hope you tune in to be with us. Folks, we've got a couple of country boys on the show this morning, just that kind of thing that you guys enjoy hearing and calling in and asking questions to. We have Doyle Palmer and Kenneth Roark from down in McDonald are here with us today. And I understand we'll probably talk a little bit about gardening, and we're going to talk a little bit about growing up country. And these guys were telling me some racing stories before we went on the air, and we'll probably hear those today too. So you stay tuned, call everybody, and tell them that the McDonald folks are on today. Today at 2 p.m., there's going to be a very special activity here in Bradley County, and I'm hoping that the rain will go away and stay away. We will be marking the graveside of a Revolutionary War soldier. Now, folks, we had people that lived here in Bradley County that fought in the Revolution. I think we had 13 people. But I only know of one gravesite, and that would be the one for Mr. Lusk down on the Hanna Farm down on Dalton Pike. We figured that most of them were buried here in Bradley County. We just don't know where. Well, David Whaley has done some extensive research, and he found Joseph Lane, and I think he's going to end up being a relative of mine, which makes it even more exciting for me. They found Joseph Lane out in the old Lee Cemetery. Now, it's not the one you see on the highway down going towards McDonald, but it's in the old Lee Cemetery. Now, Doyle, can you tell people how the best way to get there, the easiest? I looked on MapQuest, and when I read him the directions, he went, "Nah, that's going the roundabout way." So here's the easiest way to get there today at 2 o'clock.
We want to go out Highway 60, go through the Hopewell community, and when you come out to the White Oak Valley Road, just turn left, and it'll just be a short distance there on your right.
It's on Shingle Hollow Road, and I'm sure you'll see all the activity going on. This would be a great place for you to take your children. There'll be a lot of people there in Revolutionary War. I don't think they call them costumes, but that's what I call them. And they might be firing some muskets and doing those kinds of things, too. So it'll be a real short ceremony, probably from start to finish might be 40 minutes. And it's something that This is the only second time this has happened in Bradley County, so you'll want to come out and see that. And that's sponsored by the Benjamin Cleveland chapter of the Sons of the American Revolution.
Yes. And they're the ones who put up the Benjamin Cleveland statue in the downtown park.
Do a lot of good research here in Bradley County. So I hope you guys will come out and join us. Ron and I are going to be there. We have promised, unless it's raining cats and dogs, we're going to record that for them.
All right. Kenneth, tell us how long the Roark family's been down in McDonald.
Since about 1926.
Now, where did they come from before then?
Come out of a Tyner community down near Chattanooga.
All right.
Yeah, they had a open range farm, small farm in Tyner, and so this farm came open up in Bradley County, and they wanted to milk 8 cows instead of 1 or 2, so and peddle the milk. And so my granddad, my father's father, they came up, and that's what they did for a few years. They hand milk cattle, and of course started row cropping and growed their own corn to feed the cows. And but my granddad, he peddled meat and this milk, and on the farm there's a mineral spring, and he took that water, and he even sold that water off that wagon.
Mm-hmm. And the original water bottler, huh?
Yep. He did take some of that back to Chattanooga, and he did it cold weather, warm weather, and he'd warm bricks and that sort of thing, you know, on the wagon to keep warm, keep his feet warm. But he might be gone a couple of days.
Wow, country boy can survive, huh?
Yep.
Who owned that farm before the Roarks bought it?
Does
that name come to you right now?
It don't come to me. It's the... I'm lost.
Well, I know that was long before you were born.
Yeah, very
but
long.
But I knew that you probably had heard people talk about it, and it may come to you here in a few minutes.
How big was the farm?
It was 200 acres. Mm-hmm. And then my dad, the Trotter Farm, some of it came up for sale. And my dad bought 68 acres joining that farm. So that's how... I ended up where I'm at. My dad willed a farm to all of us kids, and I ended up with 68 acres because I stayed there and helped him with all the chores and haul hay, and even after I was married. And so he gave me the biggest portion of the farm. And
let's get this caller, Kenneth.
Good morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
How you doing, Ron?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
Good.
So what's going on, Brett?
I'm getting ready for graduation tonight.
And what time is that?
It starts at 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock at where?
North Cleveland.
Right, because they're afraid of weather, so they've moved it indoors. So 7 o'clock at North Cleveland, and if you don't have tickets to get in, you probably don't get in.
Hey, they're going to stream it online.
Oh, good, good. You know where, you know what the link is or anything?
It's BCHS TV.
Okay, .com?
Yes.
Okay, well, you can watch.
On that website, too.
Okay, well, great.
I'm going to the graduation.
Well, congratulations there.
Some of my friends are going to be graduating tonight.
Name some of them.
Brooke Copeland. Brooke Copeland's graduating tonight.
I knew you'd mention a girl.
Rebecca.
Uh-huh.
And one of my, Kyle Pickle.
Kyle Pickle, yeah. Boy, it's hard to imagine he's graduating high school already.
Yeah, it's right on, you know where Lee University is?
Yes, I do.
It's right.
It's close to that, yes.
Right behind Lee University off of Okoy Street.
Yeah. Yes. Well, thanks, Brett. Have a good time tonight.
You too.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye.
Let me ask you about the Trotters. You mentioned that name. Had that farm been in the Trotter family for generations before you guys bought it, or do you know?
No, not the original farm. Not the original farm was in the Trotters.
But the portion
but
that
the
your
portion
dad,
I have was in the Trotter farm.
You think that it had been at the Trotters for a long, long time, or just
yeah? Well, they were the dad, he was had some quite age on him when I was a boy. So, yeah, I think it was.
Would that be Arthur Trotter's family?
Yeah, Arthur Trotter family.
Okay, I need to talk about that a little bit. Yeah. I know that when I do research on the Trail of Tears, when one of the groups, the Bell Group, left Charleston and came down through Cleveland, they bought supplies from a Mr. Trotter in McDonnell. And I've been kind of curious about where the old roads might be going towards Chattanooga from there. And I'm sure you probably can. We need to have a big discussion about that.
Now, you was raised up on the farm?
I was born in a two-room house, and I've never left.
Tell me about the spring there.
Okay, this farm has seven springs on the southeast side.
Mm-hmm.
Two of them run about 115 gallons a minute. And the others, some of them, let's see, one of them will run at least 80 gallon or more. And one of my sisters, and she uses water out of one of those springs. And my other relatives on down south of us there, we had the big spring next to Brimer Creek Road right there at the bridge. My other sister and uncle and aunt and cousins all had water out of that spring.
Yeah, down where Eileen lives?
Yeah, where Eileen lives.
She says she has an artesian tap well,
Yeah, but now then, they had line problems, and over the years the lines deteriorated, and they all just settled. When city water came through, they all went on city water.
Went fancy time.
Hey? Yeah, yeah.
Well, let me ask you this. I know that I had the opportunity to go down on Bendabout Farm, and they brought me in on that side at Brimer Creek, which showed me where an old mill used to be. I don't know if it was the dam for the mill or if it was a bridge that was there that crossed right there at Brimer Creek. Are you familiar with that little site?
Yeah, Powder Springs area.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, that's the Powder. I think that's the Powder Springs area you're talking about there. And, of course, that Powder Spring was well before my time, and I haven't heard too much discussion about it. But I think that area, just as you come off of Lee Highway onto Brimer Creek and in those woods on the left, there is some evidence there where that powder.
Yes, and there's a real old wagon road.
Yes.
Over that's protected there by the Bendabout Farms. And, real old wagon road.
Yeah.
The traditional, the very rounded, up on the edge of the little hillside there. And I think there was some documented Civil War activity there where the troops would, of course, watch the main road there for people to come and go. Wonder why they call it Powder Springs.
I'm not sure about it. I don't know if they made some gunpowder there or what.
You don't know.
They had some kind of little resort there, too.
That's right. Yeah.
Was it Powder Resort, or do you
remember? They called it Powder Springs.
Powder Springs.
I've read a little bit about it, and my knowledge is not much.
Yeah, mine's not too much either, because it was so much before my time of being born.
That, something that south end of Bradley County, the springs and the different type of waters, is all your water the same type, or do you have different
types? Basically, all of them are the same except this one, and the reason we know it's had more minerals in it was TVA come down and tested these springs back years ago, and that's whenever they told our family that it had some minerals in it. So and they all grow great water, Chris. And people get them all the time,
Remember going down through Red Hill Valley when I was growing up. My dad just pulled his truck over, and we'd get out and pick watercress out of that little, clear stream there beside the road. And I thought, well, Lord, I wouldn't do that now for nothing. And it's not telling what's in that water now.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, that
whole McDonald area, over towards Mineral Park over there, I think they had seven different springs with seven types of water.
Yeah.
And just a short distance of each other.
Yeah, and then the old hotel, up on White Oak Mountain, they had iron water, they had the sulfur water, and they were all right beside each other. They were rocked out. My mama's uncle used to live at the bottom of that mountain, and he protected that old building for years, until he was disabled, and then, of course, everybody started going up on the mountain. That's how it finished getting burned down and That's being destroyed. And
shame that we lost that old building there. Yeah,
it's a shame that we had a mill on every creek in Bradley County, and we have none of those left.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's something you have to go down into, of course, Georgia. Prater Mill, I guess, would be the closest.
Yeah, Prater Mill.
Mill
that's
still. I don't even know if there are any mills around. Do you remember any mills, Doyle, when you were younger? Or?
Not really. Don't
I guess
remember.
I guess they had stopped. Mills had almost stopped a time in the 20s, probably. Would you think?
30s, yeah. 40, I mean, you could still get mill ground. But it was getting to be a more rare and rare
That's
thing.
Right. That's
but,
right.
Well, everything become more industrialized, and they done it more efficient.
Well, people just didn't want to grow the corn, you know. Mm-hmm. They've got out growing the hickory cane white corn, you know, that was very good for cornmeal.
All right, now, Ken, I'm going to ask you this tough question. You know, a lot of water, good water down there, and there was corn down there. Anybody make any moonshine down in them and down that McDonald area?
Only up in the White Oak Mountain area is all I ever knew. Not none around our little hills or anything that I knew about, or even south of our farm or anything. I didn't know of anybody, you know. But now over in the mountain over there in the Owl Hollow, and they call it over in that way. Yeah. Now there's plenty of it made over there.
I know they made it in Owl Hollow and up off of White Oak, because my uncle and I used to do some bird hunting, and up and down those hollers and those old fields, we could see the remnants of the stills. Apparently, we had a sheriff or two in Bradley County that got a little publicity out of destroying one of them near election time, and that influenced the voters.
Well, that's what you're supposed to do, isn't it?
That's right.
Yeah. Probably that shiner, that still was about wore out, and they made an agreement to let him blow it up, and that way then, Well, I just, you know, when you have water and you have corn, and it just almost like, you know, but.
Right where our home place is, the old farmhouse, that area and up that valley, water's very, very close to the top of the ground. My well for my house, I don't have city water on Roark Lane, but my well is 67 feet deep, and I've put a submergible pump with an inch pipe coming out, and you can't pump it dry at 67 feet.
Wow.
And the old water witchers witched that well before they dug it. And there was three streams coming in. They all met in one spot. And that's where they pounded that well to be drilled. It wasn't the auger type. It was the old pound type.
Mm-hmm.
And then just a house next door to me, they have an artesian well. It when they dug it come out of the ground when it hit the stream. And lots of water up that little valley right there.
Do you believe in that witching stuff? I mean, water witching?
It has been successful with some different ones. And long before my dad died, I had a guy from over in the Birchwood area to come over and witch a area for a well for my daughter when we was placing her on part of my farm. And he witched that water, and he proved to me that there's water there. He said, now, I can't tell you how deep, but he said, there's a lot of water there. So we dug that well, and I think it went about 130 feet deep. It was over on a little higher area, but it was artesian also. It had like two bodies of water under it. It had like a muck body of water. Then they drilled through some rocks, and then it was an artesian well. It could have pumped, it could have irrigated fields, you know, there's so much water in that well. And that just about everybody's well in that area is shallow well. Now, you go down to where my cousin lived down Bryman Creek Road, and up on that, the water gets, you got to go deep for water.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother, he built a house in the woods to the right of my house, and he had to go really deep and didn't ever hit much water, but all the way from those springs sort of run northwest. and come down in, and that's really where basically all Brimer Creek is formed, is right out of that farm there. I know of two other pretty sizable springs that come into Brimer Creek, but in the summertime there's not much water at all comes down that creek from these two springs. But there's a huge spring right there at the Trotter House, the old Trotter House, two-story house on the road, Bancroft Road. And then when they built Interstate 75, there was a huge spring up in the what they call the Cooper Place. And they tiled that spring out because they knew it would give trouble building that road. So they tiled that spring out from under the interstate. It's about center ways under I-75 coming on the north side of White Oak Mountain. And that spring runs down into Brimer Creek. So that's basically the head of Brimer Creek where it basically begins with water, is in that area.
I didn't know where it, that's good information. What all do you grow down there?
Well, I just grow garden vegetables now. Beatty View Farm, which is Julius Beatty's and Brian and Brent, they, you know, they got that sizable dairy up there in Bancroft community, but we let him have that farm, and he grows corn, wheat, soybeans, and does a good job, and we appreciate him keeping it cleaned up for us.
So what kind of vegetables are you growing?
I grow basically, I got some broccoli, cauliflower, and cabbage.
How's your broccoli doing?
I got some broccoli this year. I was afraid of the plants. I got them real early, and I think they had some of that stunt chemical on them, and they retarded a little bit. And what happens when they do that, then they have a bunch, I call them little broccolettes on them. They don't have that one huge bloom of broccoli in the center. They'll just have them all over, you know, which is still good. I mean, there's still good broccoli.
We harvested some this morning. It's not the huge heads, everything. But, of course, I can't grow good stuff anyway. So.
Well, year before last, I had some most beautiful broccoli you'd ever see in a store anywhere. And looked like my cauliflower is going to be great, though. It's really coming along. And cabbage looked like it's going to be great. And I put my Irish potatoes on Facebook. I don't know if y'all saw them or not, but I got 12 rows, or about 45 feet long each, and they some awesome plants there this year.
You know what the problem with potatoes is? You got to go get them out of the ground. Just don't jump up and pick them.
No, you got to dig them, and of course I got a plow that I hook on the back of my tractor, and it rolls them right out. Makes
there
it easy. I don't do them with a fork.
Yeah.
And it makes it really easy. It's a potato plow. Uh-huh. It's the old, it used to be pulled by a mule. But I don't have a mule no more, so I just chain it to the back of my tractor.
Mule would almost be work now, wouldn't it?
A mule would be work.
Have you ever plowed with a mule?
I have plowed with a mule. And I'll tell you a little story. When I was growing up, I was probably 6 years old before I ever knew anything about other than my granddad's old case tractor he had on the farm. It was all wore out. But anyhow, we used it as long as it would run. But my dad bought a 51 model Ford tractor, and he bought a chainsaw, McCulloch chainsaw, with a 36-inch bar on it, and that changed our lives.
Yeah.
And then when
he was on Easy Street then.
And then when you figure out how to start it, it even cut more trees.
Boy, we split that wood by hand, you know, and sawed it. My brother, I was little then, you know, when he bought that, but my brothers, they sawed that wood with cross cuts on, and have to put kerosene on the old saw sometimes, you know, to keep it from dragging. And of course, if one of them was lazy on one side, you know, it got to be trouble.
That's
because
right.
The saw wouldn't saw correctly. But yeah, that really changed our lives when my dad was able to buy that tractor and that chainsaw. Now we got to do other things in life besides it cut our time short cutting wood and working ground with a mule.
Well, now, but see what would happen? My dad would just make me cut more wood.
Yeah.
It was still easier.
Well, if you now you had to cut twice as much.
Well, we sort of served our neighbors down there too. See, so my dad, he was a giver to our neighbors, And we might have to use that saw a little more and help our neighbors out with that.
And what was your dad's name?
Charles Roy.
Charles, right.
Yes.
And then he had, how many brothers, sisters he
yeah,
had?
Yeah, he had three more brothers and three more sisters. There's seven of those.
What's all their names? You remember?
My dad's Charles, and then he had a brother, Orlando. Mm-hmm. Then he had a brother, George. He was a steel worker up in Ohio and lived in the South a little bit, but he went up north. And then James, he lived in Chattanooga. But none of them farmed but Orlando. He mm-hmm. helped. He stayed there during the war and everything, you know, and helped farm.
Now, did he live right there down towards Bancroft Road?
That's no. Eileen's no, dad. He lives. That's Eileen's father.
What's his name?
Orlando.
Orlando, yeah.
Yeah. He was a contractor, built houses in Bradley mm-hmm. County.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, who lived in the house on round down past where Eileen lives, right there on the road? If you pass Eileen's house, you take a right, then there's an older farmhouse on the left down there. Who lives in that house? Or who did?
You going west?
West or south?
You going toward Bancroft Road?
Going towards Bancroft Road, yeah.
Oh, that's my dad's old house.
That's his old home place.
Got in the curve there. That's our old home place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
His sister Eva lives there now.
Yeah. Okay.
Seemed like I went there a long time ago and talked to your dad there.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, he had a lot of visitors now. See, he worked at Western Union Telegraph Company until he was about 57 years old, and they went out of town. They went to Allentown, Pennsylvania, and he mm-hmm. didn't go. So he retired from public work then, and he kept us busy on the farm. That's how we made it. From then on, that's how we lived, is off of that farm.
Dole, where'd you grow up down that area?
Well, I grew up in the McDonald Prospect area. I was born, and I don't mind telling the people, I was born in 1938 on what is now the Tri-State Exhibition Center property. That was my granddad's farm, and there was a little house there on the farm, and my mother and dad had moved into it, so I was born there. We lived there until I was about four, and we moved to Prospect just temporarily for a couple of years maybe, and then we moved out on Pleasant Grove Road where I presently live, mm-hmm. and been there a long time. When we first moved there, we didn't have any electricity. No electricity. Everything was kerosene, cook stove, wood cook stove, wood heater with, there on the end, we probably bought a little coal from Paul Jones. But I knew what it was like to pull a cross cut, and I knew what it was like to go out and take the old axe and chop some stove wood, because we had to have it to cook those meals. And my mother was, I'm going to call her a magician in the kitchen. And she wanted us to keep her wood, and she would keep the food on the table. And but I lived there. Of course, I went away to college for 4 years, Tennessee Tech, Cookeville. And I've been living there since.
So what was it like living away from home, being a country boy like that?
Well, I went to Tennessee Polytechnic Institute in Cookeville when I went there, and it was just a country school.
Yeah,
and
Cookeville was probably pretty small too, wasn't it?
There was, I'm going to say, about 3,000 when I was there. And it was mostly, I was thinking about it a few days ago, it was mostly a boys' school. There was a few females in home ec and business, and but basically it was an engineering school for boys, and they had a nice ag department, and I went there and studied agriculture, basically. Mm-hmm. And
what a wonderful opportunity.
I enjoyed it. I wasn't out of place too badly.
Mm-hmm. Now, where did you go to grammar school at?
Well, I went to Moores Elementary. Moores Elementary was located at the end of Bancroft Road, where it tees into Harrison Pike at the present time, out near the Lackey Farm and the Beatty Farm.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a three-room school. Two rooms were classrooms, and we had a cafeteria. We had hot lunches and nice little school.
Where'd you go to grammar school?
I went to McDonald.
You went to McDonald?
Yep. Then
who were some of the teachers you guys had? Oh my gosh, that's been a little while ago,
yeah,
Debbie.
Let me go first. Okay.
All right, go ahead.
I had Miss Irene Holder. Miss Irene Holder was one of my elementary teachers, and the Holders lived on White Oak Road up there just north of actually Harrison Pike area. And I had Mrs. Atchley. Mrs. Atchley lived over there near the Bachman Home area. Excuse me. And I had Mrs. Ira Barber. Mrs. Barber lived out at Prospect, and she was a jewel of a teacher. I really learned a lot. And the deal was that we were in the same classroom for 4 years. You know, we went fifth through the eighth in one room, and first grade through the fourth in the other. But now there's one little catch to my elementary days. I actually started in the primer. Mm-hmm. And then they did away with the primer, and some of the people that I graduated with from high school with were actually a year younger than me, because they didn't have to go that year in the primer. And but I had a good tenure. Like I said, we had hot lunches. It was really a treat to go to the cafeteria for lunch. And our play period, we just had outside play when the weather would permit. Competitive athletic teams, we had a little bit of a basketball team, and we'd play two or three other schools around. I remember we used to play Prospect in softball, and we didn't have enough people to field a team. And Mr. Elmore was the principal and the coach at Prospect, and he would let us borrow one of his players. And you all know, or you heard of, Joe Collins. And I can remember Joe used to be one of the one of the players that Mr. Elmore would let us borrow.
Well, did he let you borrow a good one?
Well, he just said Joe.
Well, Joe. You know, Joe was pretty good.
And, now, that Herman's brother, Herman and Pete.
Yeah, in that family, yes. Yeah. And actually, we had two females that were pretty good in our school that would play with the boys on the softball team.
Good morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Hey, Ron, I'd like to say hello to Doyle. Anybody knows anything about Prospect or Brady High School knows the name Doyle Palmer.
Morning, Bullet. How are you, buddy?
Deb, thanks to you, I've come across some papers. They're about ready to tear up on me, but I've come across some papers. And my father's my grandfather had a farm on Blue Springs Road. It was 350 acres. Uh-huh. And I think they farmed a team of horses back then in the 1920s. And thanks to you, I've just come across some history about my family.
Well, good.
And I think anybody knows anything about Blue Springs Road. Remember the old Taylor house out there? I think it's where their farm was.
Okay. Is the house still there, Bullet?
Yes, it is. It's that big old 2-story white house on the right. When you go, Bobby Scott lives right. Bobby Scott said he can look at his window, and he remembers my family living there. I wasn't there. I wasn't born then.
Okay.
My father and him was, but anyways, old Taylor house, I think.
I hope it stays there.
Anyway, I'm enjoying the show, and I just want to say hello to Doyle and guest. Okay. Thanks to you, I've just come across some history.
Okay,
in my
good.
Family.
Hang on to it.
Yeah, I am.
Thank you, Bullet. Bye-bye.
Dole, let me ask you a question. You know, I've known you a long time now, you know, 40 years probably or something like that. Did you ever get any mischief? You always seem like one of these people who never got in any trouble, never did anything wrong. I've never known
Kenneth's
you.
Kenneth's grinning.
So now you got to tell on yourself right now. Did you ever get any mischief when you was in school and high school and stuff?
Well, I don't think I did anything really bad.
I didn't say bad.
I never served any detention. Basically, the only time I got called into Mr. Clemmer's office was when she wanted me to open a box with my pocket knife. She knew I carried a pocket knife with me. And my mother insisted that I be a good boy.
Well, my mom did too, but it didn't work all the time, you know. I got into
a
little trouble.
So, Dole, if you had gotten into trouble, what would have happened when you got home?
Well, there was a little bit of entertainment that was going to take place.
Right, a little bit of action. Yeah.
Well, Ken, did you ever get in trouble in school?
No, sir. Only trouble I got into going to grammar school was I'd go squirrel hunting before I'd go to school.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Miss Kelly was one of my teachers. She was a principal. And at that time, she's the one that questioned what I was coming to school, you know, 10 minutes late for.
Mm-hmm.
I might be 10 minutes late. And of course, we had to walk to school.
Well, squirrels just weren't right by there, were they?
Yeah.
You had to go find the squirrels.
Yeah, you had to go down on Brimer Creek and up on the ridge there and find them. So, but.
Did you take your gun to school?
That's about the only thing I did. And of course, in high school, I did get some detention one time and I've told this many, many times, and I got frustrated at Miss Clemmer because I was not guilty. But Coach Davis came in the restroom down at the bleachers, you know, and there was about five or six of us in there, and there was four boys in there pitching pennies up against the wall. Well, I was not guilty of that. I just went in to use the restroom, and then I was going on to the agriculture building, and he grabbed me by the arm. He said, nope, says, you can't leave. Said all of you got to go see Miss Clemmer. Said, we can't permit this. I said, Coach Davis, I was not pitching pennies. And them boys, you know, they didn't say nothing, you know. They knew they was caught too. But anyhow, all those pennies was laying up against the wall. And I got, I think I got 2 hours detention out of that I really didn't deserve that time. But I really didn't get in no trouble. I was a pretty good boy, I think, growing up.
That means they were really good or they were just too smart not to get caught. That's one of those two things. Well, you had mentioned a lot of things, but tell me about going to Cleveland Speedway, both of you, when it first opened up and around that time, or any activities that you were involved in down there. I know both of you went.
Well, my first experience was at Cleveland Speedway. We drove up on the bank, I guess you would call it a bank at that time, and parked our vehicle and watched from where the concession press box building would be presently. We just got out, and I'm not sure about any admission. I'm not, I don't remember that, but I went with Mr. Ramsey, who was Herbert Lackey's granddad. He had a little interest in racing, and maybe Julius and Larry Parker, two of Herbert's cousins. And a couple of names, seemed like I can remember a Winston Patterson and and maybe a Wampler. I'm not sure about the first name on that. That we just watched them play in the mud.
Yeah, J.B. Wampler?
Could have been.
J.B. Then Winston Patterson, they called him the Fence Buster.
Yes. Yeah. And anyway, we watched them play in the mud there for several days or events before they probably opened it to the public and started charging admission.
So this is about 54, 1954?
Somewhere in that area, yes. And I can, I'll relay one more little story and then I'll let Kenneth talk. I was there one night and Wayne McGuire had won all the races all summer. And they put up a bounty for anybody that could beat Wayne McGuire. It was probably $2,000 or more. And so there was one of the Friars, I don't remember if it was Harold or Freddie, but on the last lap, I think he actually ran off of the track partially into the infield and beat him to the finish line. And apparently the judges let it stand, and Friars got the big pot.
I'd say it was Harold, because I don't think Freddie really started driving until the mid-50s, and I would think that was before that. Now, I don't know much about Wayne McGuire. I know he was from Kentucky, and I know that he won a lot of races, and he won enough races that he did it for his living. He built cars, and he raced for a living. And you can't tell much by looking at pictures, but he looks like he was always a real happy-looking guy. Big smiling, big-looking fella. And the earliest car I think I actually have a picture of him with is maybe his Skeeter. Maybe I have one before that. Do you remember Wayne McGuire?
Yes, I remember Wayne real well. You know, he would race up in Knoxville, then he'd come to Cleveland Speedway. And, of course, when he came down, he started taking all the races. When I was a teenager is when I got into the racing a little bit. Jack Cunningham moved into our community. He just lived just half a mile down the road from our house, and then he got us to go into the races with him. And of course, like I told you before the show, we pretty much stayed up in the stands. We didn't go to the infield or anything, but we could have. I mean, he could have got us in the infield, but we would go down into the infield after the races, and that's when all the socializing went on with Jack and all the Friars and Wayne McGuire. But Wayne came into town, and he cleaned everybody's playoff for many, many, many weeks, and probably a couple of years.
I'm thinking that he won every race he entered,
basically. He did. He won every heat that he'd enter.
And if he finished it, he won it.
Yeah, and he never banged his car up because he's always out front, and he didn't have to. But he was an excellent driver. But how I got acquainted with him, when Jack moved into the community, he fixed a basement under his house, and that's where his shop was to work on his race car.
Let's get this car here.
Okay.
Go ahead, call. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Morning, Ron.
Morning.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Oh, we're here. Go ahead, Neil.
Okay. That was Harold Friar that won the bounty on Wayne. Wayne McGuire's car was Pontiac powered, and it would flat fly if it could get the power to the ground.
Yeah.
another interesting thing about those cars, it was the super modified era. And Freddie was racing by then. He had a black number 48 cut down 34 Ford coach. But they would run the same cars on asphalt and dirt. They would change shocks and tires and gear ratios, and they'd run at Boyd's on Friday night and then Cleveland on dirt on Saturday night. But another interesting thing about Wayne McGuire, too, he made his living at that. He wasn't just a weekend racer. He made a living. And also had a speed shop in Grayson, Kentucky. But that Pontiac, fuel-injected Pontiac with flat screen, I mean, it was a mover. So, enjoying the show.
Thank you, Neil.
All right.
What always amazed me, I would go for the entire show, and they would start out with those old junkers, and they would play around in the mud. And those guys really had a lot of fun, I think. And but by the end of the race card, they got down to that final run, that track was ironed out, and it looked like it was pretty firm. And so those guys with the horsepower could get around there in a hurry.
They could sling them little mud balls still, though.
Yeah, they would, down next to the fence.
So you talk about McGuire, how you got to know him?
When Jack built his house in our community, he set his basement up for his repair shop or his shop for his race car to work on it until later he built him a garage out back that he worked on it. But Wayne would come down to Jack's, and when they'd race at Boyd's, he would come to Jack's shop, and they would change the suspension under his car there at his house. And that's how I got to know Wayne real well. And he and Jack were basically the same type people. They were just super nice people all the time.
Jack was one of the happiest guys I ever met
always,
in my life.
Always. Just never a dull moment. He always wanted to have fun. And And I remember in y'all's documentary where they said he pulled in one time, mm-hmm. you know, because he's tired. More likely, Jack had somebody behind him that he wanted to win that race, and he just pulled over and let him have it. And, you know, I don't know what part of the race that was in, where the last or what.
Yeah, but they said 17 or 20 laps.
Yeah, well, mm-hmm. he probably seen that car behind him or something, because I ain't never seen Jack give up racing if he wanted to race. But he done it for pleasure. He didn't do it to win, no mm-hmm. way. He mm-hmm. just enjoyed the atmosphere and all the friends he had, and he just both of them are just super nice cars. And Wayne was the same way. But, yeah, Wayne, he and the Friars got in a little confrontation at Boyd Speedway one time because they couldn't win the race down there, and there was some flashlight slinging, and Wayne got injured.
That happens down there in those tracks there. Growing up, you know, I live behind the racetrack. That's where I live at now. Yeah. And so I'd walk over there, and I was there 67 through 74, probably my most active times over there. And, of course, and what was the guy from Knoxville that ran all the time? His name
was Tootle Estes.
Yeah, he is good.
I said, how do you forget that name?
Tell me about Tootle's – I mean, was a Tootle driving, was he just – a wild and crazy driver, or was he skilled, or did he have good cars?
No, he had good cars. I remember, seemed like he had a red car in that super modified or skeeter, but best I remember, he had a good car.
And he was another guy that he built cars for a living, and he ran for a living. He made his living his entire life being a race car driver. And That's a pretty interesting character, too. I was talking the other day. I had the opportunity. Fox 61 came up and interviewed me for Racing Tonight, which is a show that's going to show May 27th, I think it is. I'll let you guys know next week. And they interviewed the folks down at the museum because they're going to do a big exhibit about race car drivers and stuff. But Dave Wright Jr. came up and was being interviewed, and after the interview he told the greatest stories. You know, you get kind of nervous during the interview, and he did a good job, but you know, we were there for a long time, and he was telling that they had a transmission that went out, somebody pulled their family car in, they took the transmission out, put it in the race car, raced it, and then put it back in the same night. And I'm thinking, well, you can't get a transmission fixed in 4 days at a shop now. But I thought that was pretty funny that they just, well, it's all right, just, you know, here, use my transmission.
Yeah.
I thought that kind of stuff was funny. But that apparently, those kinds of things went on all the time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
You never know when you was in that infield what was going to take place when you get a car back on track and get it going.
Now, do you guys think that, were you guys on there the first day that it opened, the Cleveland Speedway? Do you think you were there?
I wasn't.
I'm not sure if I was there on opening day or not, but I was there early on. The Chases, I believe, opened that.
They did.
And talked to some of the Chases, and they don't have any of the pictures. And they said they had tons of pictures, and over the years, people apparently borrowed pictures without their knowledge.
Yeah.
Or borrowed and didn't return.
And so they just, they don't have anything. And so it's sort of sad, you know.
But they were really excited that we did this.
And Deb just completed the book about that, too. You know, we did the documentary.
Yeah.
But now we have a book with more pictures that we had just collected that didn't make the documentary. And we could have made the documentary 3 hours long. I mean, we have that much stuff.
We could have taken Jack Cunningham and the Friars and made a 2-hour documentary.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's just the tip of the iceberg, but I think it's enough to encourage people to save their own family histories about it. I think one of my favorite stories that's in the book that didn't make the documentary because, you know, no one told it. I was talking to one of the Doss boys, and they said his daddy ran the very first race, the very first day at the Cleveland Speedway. And on the first lap, on the first corner, he spun out, and somebody hit his engine real hard and knocked his carburetor off. And so he had to go in and repair and then get back in the race later. But I said, well, that's a pretty good story. The first day, first race, first lap.
First wreck.
First wreck.
Another reason why they had Kenneth over there happened to retool that car to get ready for the Cleveland Speedway, they needed a big strong guy over there to do some tugging and pulling and lifting. So that
and probably free labor too.
We had fun.
It was fun. Yeah, but it's free labor.
We had fun. But
there's lots of pictures from the Wright family Bob Wright and Dave Wright Sr. and Dave Wright Jr., of them working in the garage. I mean, you know, how everybody else has family picnic pictures. Well, that's where the family stayed all the time. His wife's hand-painting the lettering on the car, and, you know, somebody's working on each end of it. And I think that you don't realize how much time and energy went into keeping those cars on the track.
It's a lot of time, It was every bit of their spare time, and then sometime they didn't really need to be there. They were doing it.
Good morning, live on Old Town Cleveland.
Hi, Ron.
Hey.
It's just Bob Gill.
Hey, Bob. How are you, sir?
How are you, my friend?
Doing fine, ma'am. And you?
Tell me about Tootle. I know you knew Tootle Estes.
Yeah, I knew Tootle real well. I used to help. Let me turn this radio down. I used to help Tootle, and me and Sonny Callahan used to help him at the racetrack and when he was driving the guy's car out of Athens, Georgia, on Jabbo. But I was really young at the opening day, and I had to slip in. I didn't have enough money to get in, so I slipped in.
I'm sure you were the only person that ever did that, Bob Gill.
But anyway,
Bob, in our book, there's a picture of you and Tootle in the pits, I guess, at Cleveland.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you look like you're probably 14, maybe 12. Yeah. Somewhere.
I'll be up there tomorrow. I didn't get to come to the first one, but I'll be there tomorrow.
I know that Man Hawkins is going to be there tomorrow. You probably know him from racing. And some other fellas, Bobby Ritchie and his family is going to be there. And come on out. You'll see some folks you hadn't seen in a while. And call some folks up and tell them to come out.
I will. And
it's 3 o'clock tomorrow at Walker Valley High School.
I remember Jack Cunningham, right hand there, that's on the show today. And Wayne McGuire, I talked to Wayne McGuire about a year before he died. I was up in Grayson, Kentucky, and I was stopped at a little old truck stop for getting some fuel, and the UPS man come in there in Grayson, and I asked him, I said, you know a fellow named Wayne McGuire? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, could you give me his address? He said, I'll give you his address, telephone number, and everything.
He probably wasn't supposed to do that, but I'm glad he did.
So I called Wayne, and at that time, he was in a wheelchair, and he was totally blind. And but I talked to his wife, and she let me talk to him for a minute, but since then, he's passed away.
I believe he had an accident.
Yes, he did.
And that kind of led to the end of his racing career. But I believe he was a shop teacher there in Grayson, Kentucky for a long number of years and still did some stuff, you know, what he could.
Well, he had that, and it broke, paralyzed from the waist down.
Oh.
But he
was up in Illinois, was he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was still in good spirit when I talked to him and everything, and we were talking about Ivan Stevens and the Friars and everybody, and the first thing that he asked me was if I knew Jack Cunningham.
There you go.
So, yeah, we talked about Jack and everything, but listen, I'll get off here, and I'll see y'all tomorrow.
Looking forward to it, Bob, 3 o'clock. Okay. Be there early. Bye-bye. I think we're going to have a good crowd tomorrow. Yeah. It's going to be a fun, energized crowd.
Let me ask Ken about down in McDonald, have any ever crazy things happen? You know, I know the Borings sort of shot a sheriff down there one time down in that area. And,
did that shooting actually happen down in that community, or was it over in Blue Springs?
No, I think for sure they were right there. Don't you remember where that happened?
I'm not sure where it happened. See, I was not a McDonald guy.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like there was a dividing line,
yeah.
And we very seldom crossed that
you
line.
You stayed in your community.
So I stayed up north, even though I'm on the McDonald.
So you didn't want to get down them big boys like the Roarks down there and get whipped.
That, it was just different communities for some reason, yeah. You know.
Transportation was one of the big things, wasn't
yeah.
it? You mean,
yeah, oh, yeah.
That was a problem.
Yeah, we walked there where we went.
Yeah, you didn't walk too far. But now the Borings lived there in the McDonald area.
Yeah,
and,
some of them, last ones I knew about was down on South McDonald Road.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they would handle theirselves.
they didn't
brag. They didn't talk. You know,
Chip Bryant or John Cook, I think, know exactly where the there was a raid on a steel somewhere down in there, and they shot Israel Smith.
Yeah,
down there. So and. Any other things, wild things happened? I know where a bootlegger used to live down there.
Well,
go ahead, Kenneth. Ask him how he knows
only
that.
Only bad thing, I guess the worst time things happened around Halloween, you know, all the pranks people did on.
Flip the toilets over.
That's right. Yeah, turn them toilets
I was
over.
In a patrol car and got egged down there in McDonald's. Yeah. Good morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Good morning, Ron and Debbie.
Hey, Joe.
Good morning, Joe.
I've got this VHS tape here at the house. It's about racing, and it shows tells where a guy had built this engine. I can't remember all about it, but run off with something and run. I forget how many miles an hour. It was way up there. Do they know anything about that?
No, I don't think so. You know, I think, Joe, something we have to remember about NASCAR, I mean, they finally got to going so fast that they had to put the restrictor plates on them to slow them down so they could stay on the track.
Yeah.
So I think at some point in time, our horsepower got bigger than their brains.
Yeah, well, this right here tells me they disqualified. I mean, wouldn't let him run it on the street or anything.
But we need to see it and, you know, look at it.
I've got that tape. I'll find it.
And I still got your John Wayne movie.
Well, I know that. I ain't worried about it.
All righty, Joe. Thanks.
Hey, I've got this other movie right here on VHS. It's The Making of Champions.
Uh-huh.
And it shows how Dale Earnhardt got his start and Richard Childers and a couple more. I'll bring it to you
and
look at it.
All righty. Thank you.
All right. Bye.
And for somebody that wants a little bit different experience, on the 25th, which is next Sunday, we're going to go down and show the documentary at the Georgia Racing Hall of Fame at 2 o'clock. And I know there's going to be, I mean, Charles Barrett's going to be there and Charles Mincy and all of those guys out of Georgia are going to be there. And I think it'll be a fun time. Charlie Mincy openly mentions running moonshine.
If you're a real racing fan, there's some really Hall of Famers down there. It's 2 hours away. So let me ask you a question now. Statute of limitations is gone, so anything that you've done in the past, you know, you can tell, and your family's not listening or Nathan. So what about Mineral Park and places down there? I mean, they used to have some dances and some fights and a little shooting and shoving.
They had some good dances down there. Huge crowds. Uh-huh. You couldn't have a parking place. And I guess if you ever drove by there while you was on the city or county force, you saw what was there. But, yeah, they had a few knife cuttings. And I think one skirmish might have related from an argument up there at Mineral Park, and a lady got shot in her trailer just down the road, you know, with some buckshot and stuff like that. But that they never did find the results of that. And so there was a little bit went on, but Mr. Pohl, who run that thing all my time I knew, he kept it pretty clean down there, other than in the back room playing cards and gambling a little bit.
A little bit in the back room,
But he was always radioed when they had to come down, and he would announce it, so they was all sitting at the bar drinking their beer then.
Did drink any moonshine back there in the back?
Probably so. Because it's probably made right the back there a little bit.
Now, right up behind there, off to the right, if you're facing it to the right, there's a lot of cabins right up there, were they not?
Yeah, they used to have some cabins up there.
Yeah, that was part of the old Mineral Park when it was
resort. That's right. That's right.
But people started living in those little cabins. They were just little small cabins.
Yeah, just little small. Yeah, that's right. And of course, they had goat barbecues down there and all that. They There's a lot went on down there.
Now, I've never had barbecue goat. How
I
is that?
I haven't either. I've never ate it.
You just knew it was there?
No. The only thing I've eaten out of the way is probably a groundhog one time. My mom baked a groundhog one time. It wasn't bad. It was all dark meat. But it wasn't bad at all.
Now, did you put sweet potatoes around it?
No, not the groundhog. You know, a possum.
Oh.
You're supposed to put sweet potatoes and stuff around possum. But I never eat no possum either, but.
Well, I don't know. He might not qualify as a country
now,
boy.
Dole and P-Dab was in here one day, and they talked about the difference between which was better, possum or muskrat. And I think they come up with that muskrat was better than possum.
It might be just the thoughts. You know.
So you raised on a farm, had pigs
and
cows.
You know, a possum, you know, you might, back in my kid days, if you had a cow or a horse to die, you just drug him way back in the woods. And then if you had possum dogs, you went possum hunting, and you'd end up running possums out of the cavity of those dead animals. So it's probably the thoughts of what they eat versus what a muskrat eats.
Yeah,
you know, muskrat vegetarian totally.
So have you had muskrat?
No, I've never eaten no muskrat.
See, now, Dole's ahead of you. He's had all this stuff here. He's
a world traveler.
Dole, how is a muskrat?
Well, I'm sure I've eaten a lot of things that I didn't know what it was.
And glad to have it, right?
Ron, now, I want to make one announcement here before.
My mother was pretty strict about what she processed and cooked through her kitchen. And some things she would... just listen to you, and she'd say no.
No. I want to announce that on May the 24th, the Warbirds Over Cleveland flying will happen, and it's hosted by the Bradley County Remote Control Model Aircraft Club. Easy for me to say. There's a fee for the pilots to participate, but it's free for the spectators. And you bring your chair, and it's on Francisco Road in Georgetown. And if you need more information, you can call James Patterson. His number is 479-8449. Ron, when we come back from the break, we'll have someone from the Sons of the American Revolution with us talking about the decoration today. And we're
open house at the fire departments.
Oh, that's right.
All the Cleveland fire departments. Take your kids by and see all the fire trucks there. Hey, we'll be back in just a moment, folks. We're going to take a break. We'll be back here on Old Town Cleveland.
You're listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
You need money overnight? Check into cash. Your time is tight.
.com.
Bank account's too low? Check into cash.
So where do you go?
.com. Do it online in a record time. It's the easy way to get money next day. Do a quick click from home
at checkintocash.com.
Just stay in the house.
Check into cash.
And grab your mouse.
.com.
Get your money online.
Check into cash.
Right on time.
.com.
You can be sure it's secure from our bank straight to yours. Do a quick click from home
at checkintocash.com.
No time to get away.
Check into cash.
You gotta stay home.
.com.
Hey, that's okay. Check into cash.
You can do it alone.
.com. Any old time, do it online. Just stay in the house and grab your mouse. Do a quick click from home.
Get your money overnight at the right website.
Do a quick click from home.
Go to checkintocash.com.
Wheeler Technologies has moved. Visit them at their new location at 490 Grove Avenue Southwest next to Bradley Rentals. Same great folks, same great service with a better location to serve you. Call Wheeler Technologies for voice, data, and security needs at 664-TECH. That's 664-8324. And remember, depend on Wheeler Technologies for the current time and temperature every day at 476-1111. Tennessee Alarm Contractor C175.
In the nation, we're behind you 100%. Add brand new belongings from Nationwide Insurance, and we'll replace stolen or destroyed items with brand new versions.
Call Eric Neff, Nationwide Insurance, Brian Norton Agency, downtown Cleveland, 599-1026.
Nationwide is on your side.
Optional feature exclusions and limits apply. Damaged items may be repaired. Consult policy language for specifics. Nationwide Mutual Insurance Company and Affiliates, Columbus, Ohio.
here was done. Gone home.
They have gone home.
Gone
they
home.
They have gone home.
Welcome back to Old Town Cleveland. That's a song we play every week called Gone Home for all those people in our community who's passed on. Just our little remembrance of them, and bless all those families. Deb's trying to get someone on the phone here for us. We're going to be talking, but we were talking about the Mineral Park and then all the cabin, Ball Springs, those cabins back there, and that's actually, they filmed some of the Wild River back in those cabins.
Yes.
Go ahead there.
Ball Springs was there on Harrison Pike, and the Engle family owned that property, and they had a big farmhouse down at the end of their driveway, and on the right side of the driveway going down, they had five or six small cabins that people lived in, just like a one-room deal, but mm-hmm. some people lived there for a few years. And they had a dance hall across the creek there by the mineral spring that was at Ball Springs.
And the main reason they went down there was because of the minerals and everything. Everybody thought that was healing properties, and it's just bad tasting water to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, we got someone here on the phone, and Deb, go ahead.
Good morning, David. How are you this morning, buddy?
Well, good morning, Deb and Ron. We're just out here enjoying this little bit of a sprinkling, getting ready to have ourselves a grave marking ceremony.
Certainly hope that the rain holds off, and I think it will. I think it's going to pass on through, and it'll be clear today. Go ahead and invite the public out and tell them what the Sons of the American Revolution, the Benjamin Cleveland chapter, is doing today.
We are having a commemorative service to mark the grave, the installation of a stone proclaiming a Revolutionary War soldier that's buried here in Bradley County as a patron, so that coming generations will remember the fact that this is a person who helped establish the United States of America as a free country. We only have 13 Revolutionary soldiers that are buried in Bradley County. And this is the second one that we've been able to find their grave. And that's one of the purposes of the Sons of the American Revolution, is to find Revolutionary War soldiers and mark their graves so that future generations will be able to find them.
That's amazing that you found it. And how did you find that?
Well, it just this cemetery is located off of the White Oak Valley Road, Shingle Hollow Road, and this is a little community cemetery that's been here for ages and ages, and we just sort of suspected that since this is one of, I think, the three oldest cemeteries in Bradley County, we figured he had to be here, or one of the other two, and luckily we found him here.
And see, sometimes we know they're there, they just don't have a marking, or there's no indication that anyone had ever said that they were there. So
right.
We were really fortunate that you guys were able to establish that.
Absolutely. In fact, he has an old fieldstone marker that was erected, and someone took a hammer and a chisel and carved his name and his dates on it. And we were able to scrub the stones and find that information to where we knew exactly who he was and what the story was with him.
Absolutely. And I hope that has been that stone's still there, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, that's exciting.
The old fieldstone is here, and he is buried beside his wife.
Absolutely excellent. So that'll be at 2 p.m. today. And what can folks that are coming expect to see?
Okay, we will have a color guard, just a color. The color guard, I think we have 19 people that will be in the color guard. They'll be dressed in various forms of Revolutionary era clothing. We have found, I think it's 24 of his descendants. Some of them have come in from Florida, some from Alabama, Tennessee, South Carolina, and Georgia to honor their ancestor. A lot of them didn't know where he was at. And the ceremony will last probably 30 minutes, and at the end of it, we will have a flintlock musket volley to commemorate his service.
There you go. That sounds like fun to me.
Now, this would be a great thing for if you got some young boys and girls that to come out to learn about history. The muskets is just the attraction to get them there, but to learn about history, and this would be a great time to teach a little history to our kids and have fun at the same time.
Absolutely. Well, we have his fifth great-grandson who lives here in Cleveland that is going to read the text of his pension application, which will list the various forms of service that he performed in the 18 months that he served. He was present at the surrender at Yorktown, and actually this gentleman we're going to commemorate today would have seen George Washington that day.
Well, that's amazing.
That's kind of exciting, isn't it?
That is, and I think that if I could get my hands on that family tree, I'm in that tree.
Well, that's a good place to be.
Yeah, I think I'm out of the Lane family. They came out of Virginia, so I think it's probably a pretty good bet. And I believe they landed in Monroe County and came down into Bradley County. So sounds kind of familiar to me.
Well, we hope that people will come out and join us today. We have some canopies up here. We hope we'll have enough to keep people in the dry, and if not, bring an umbrella, because this is truly an unusual and historic occasion for Bradley County.
And if you're able, carry your own chair, too. They probably have some chairs there, but it always helps when you bring your own. What about parking up there today, David?
We have pretty adequate parking. They extended this cemetery. The gentleman that owns the land donated some more land, and I'm sure there'll be adequate parking today.
Absolutely. We appreciate everything that you and your fellow brothers and the Sons of the American Revolution do here. I know I saw some pictures in the newspaper this week of you guys doing presentations in schools, and we appreciate that. And we're going to see you about 1:30 then.
And, David, I look forward to coming back to meetings. I've been in a class for the last 3 months, and so my class ends June 5th, and I should be able to start coming back.
Law, you'll be so smart when we see you.
No.
He'll have a green thumb now.
Yeah,
the court's ordered me to go to this class, so I'm about to.
Thanks, David. Have a great day, and we'll see you in a little bit.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You know, I think sometimes if you're not paying attention, you don't realize how many people are out making this community a better place to live. And the Sons of American Revolution have done some incredible research in the families here in Bradley County.
And if you'd like to become a member, just contact me. It's Sons of American Revolution. We have an organization here. one of the largest in the state of Tennessee. And basically, they have to trace your ancestors back and have absolute proof that a member of your family was in the American Revolution. I'm very fortunate to have someone in my family. Now, I don't have any Confederates of mine, but they all lived here in Bradley County, and they're all on that other side. I don't know what happened to them. They're all on wore blue instead of gray here. But
he does have a lot of revolutionary.
Yeah, matter of fact, I had like five different people that somewhere down through my family that was there.
Pretty amazing that the track, the paperwork trail was still there.
Yeah, good. So, Roark, what do you know the origin of your name? Is that a German Irish name, or do you know?
Probably Irish. Now, my grandma was a German, and my grandma Roark was a German. I mean, she was a huge woman. She's big bone. She built chicken houses. She did everything on that farm.
Mm-hmm. What was her maiden name?
Her name was, that's lost.
Grandma.
Yeah.
Grandma.
That's what it was.
And that'll come. You'll be standing in line at CVS here in a little while, and you'll say it.
I asked a question on Facebook every day. I asked some silly question to see what kind of answer comes. Yeah. And I said, what was your mother's great-grandfather's names? And they had no earthly idea. They said, you know, they said Papaw, Grandpa, and everything. But, you know, and thanks to Deb being doing a lot of research, I actually knew mine. I was going, hey, well, I can do that. Yeah. You always know your father's side of the family a little bit better because you are a Roark. And it's easy. Yeah. There were Roarks.
Yeah. But then my grandma's name was Ella now. Huh? My grandpa was George Washington. They named him.
All right. Dole, what was your mom's family's name?
Well, my mother was a Bancroft.
That's right.
And
I remember that name.
Her dad was George Bancroft, and her mother was Millie. And they lived, like I said a while ago, on the tri-state property for years. And she had four adult sisters and five adult brothers. And they all grew up and married and basically just scattered all over the country.
Now, are you related to any of the Withrows out through there?
Well, I don't think I'm...
Because, you know, they own property along through that ridge through there, too.
I was very familiar with the Bill Withrow family. Linda was one of their daughters.
And, Teresa.
I went to school, Linda, married to Lawrence Matthews. We were in the same class at Bradley, and I knew them very well. And,
I like her because she likes all my jokes.
And then there was some of those Withrows were synonymous with lumber, timber.
And playing ball out at Prospect.
Playing ball at Prospect.
Oh, gosh,
I think at one time they had a... They had a little team that was about all Withrows.
Yeah, that except for maybe Shelton. Max Shelton, I think, was only non-Withrow on the team.
Yeah.
Well, Dole Withrow and lived out through there. And
But anyway, my granddad was a very strong church person. He was Church of God. And I have a little bit of information I wanted to talk about, and this will probably be a good time.
Go ahead.
He donated the property where the Bancroft Cemetery is. Bancroft Cemetery is right near my house. And he donated 1 acre in 1931 to the Church of God for the tabernacle and the cemetery. And I got to looking at some of the old markers, and actually, one of his half-sisters had a little infant buried there in 1927, actually before he donated the property.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a timber guy. He was a farmer. He drove a school bus. Near the end of his life, he sold the property there and moved to Prospect. He lived right near the entrance to Prospect Elementary, and he had a little country store there. And he had a little accident building a fire and was burned and passed away. And I was only 12 years old. And they wouldn't let me go up and see him. He was in the PNS hospital. And I've never forgiven them that for that, because they let babies go into the hospital now. But anyway, that was a rule back then, and they were strict. And anyway, he passed away. And I had one Uncle Frank, who's was Jerry's dad. He was a cattleman. I had another Uncle Howard. He was a cattle person. I had an Uncle Otis, who was a truck driver for Frank, and he was killed in a truck accident at a fairly young age. And then Thomas Smith, who was basically a factory worker. And they were just a wonderful group of uncles. I'll just put it that way.
That's something you miss, is those big families, like, you know, my mom, there's like five or six of them, without counting here real quick. But, you know, the big family on Sunday, you go have, grandma always had food.
That's right.
A lot of food on Sunday, and everybody sat around and ate, and we didn't watch cable, and we didn't have cell phones, no Facebook or anything. We sat around on front porch and swung, and I listened to them. And then I'd ask my grandpa questions. I wish I'd listened to some of the answers now. Yeah. Who are some of all the neighbors that live down in McDonald? I mean, you know, you got the Roarks. What other family names are down there?
Well, they, you know, are you talking about now or
just over the years growing up?
Yeah, well, the Roddies and, of course, the Earlses lived down in that area. And Davises. There's some Davises there. And
Carsons and Coopers.
Yeah, Carsons, Cooper. A lot of the Carsons have died, you know, but there's still Gail Carson that lives over on the highway. She's part of the old family Carson that lived down on Brimer Creek, owned that farm down there that Neil Henry owns now.
Yeah, Neil. Yeah.
So,
Kelly's. Kelly's another.
Yeah, there's a few Kelly's.
What about down Al Hollow Road? Who's all down through there?
I don't know more about that than I would.
I really didn't know too many of them. When you turn off of Harrison Pike and go on to, which would be north Al Hollow Road, just a little ways up there, you get to the Cantrells.
Yeah.
And Glenn Cantrell's family still lives in that area. Mm-hmm. And, of course, his mother and dad were there.
And I think his wife was a member of the
Ford family.
Ford family was the snake handling family.
Yeah.
So he knows a lot about that, and more than I want to know.
The Cantrells have been there for generations because you know, there was a Civil War soldier out of that family that lived in that community. He was a Union soldier.
Yeah, right down
there's
there.
Some Sherlin.
Andrew Jackson. Sherlin.
Yeah, I know. There's Sherlin right there at Fire Tile Road.
That's right. That's
yeah,
right.
It sure is, yeah.
What I knew about snake handling was the big entertainment on Saturday was to go to town. We always went to town on Saturday to get groceries and do a little shopping. And around the old courthouse, on one side you'd have a church service. On the other side, the sock lady. Over in another section, the winos would be over there straining shoe polish, drinking it. But they would have the church service.
Good old-fashioned entertainment.
Yeah.
Thing a kid like shoe polish?
They would have church service. And this is serious business. I'm not belittling these people at all.
Oh, they're very serious.
They have strong convictions about it, and a lot of them were from, you know, Dolly Pond and Grasshopper area.
Oh yeah.
But they had their church service, and I've seen them handle snakes right there on the courthouse square on Saturday.
You were across the street when they were handling.
No, actually, I was pretty close. I was curious and interested, I guess, and. But those people had strong convictions, that was
sincere convictions.
We had Dr. Hood from Chattanooga, from UTC, come up, and who's an expert on snake handling churches and all that. And it's just unbelievable. But, yeah, their faith, you can't question it. Now, it probably isn't for me or most people, but you have to admit, you know, and they're still going on. I mean, I don't know how much in this area. Well, yeah. Matter of fact, we went over to where the Dolly Pond Church used to be, where George Wynn Hensley thing, and the graveyard's across the street. And we went up and seen a lot of those names that are from that. Did you do any snake handling down there?
No, that the Hensley is some of my wife's
family?
Cousin's family.
George
yeah.
Wynn Hensley.
George
yeah.
was, yeah.
Yeah, he.
My wife has a lot of literature on him.
It just fascinating me to read that about that. You know, of course, George was actually appointed by A.J. Thomason to be a Church of God preacher.
Yeah.
And, of course, after he started handling the snakes, I think that they finally sort of separated ways with him, and he started this holiness church.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
this is not chicken snakes and black snakes either.
No.
These are serpents that copperheads and rattlesnakes.
I don't reach down and get the rat snakes or the chicken snakes either. I mean, they can bite you too.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, now, they'll bring the blood from you also.
Now, down in that area, do you have a lot of snakes down in McDonald?
It's just by spells. I've not seen too many this year. There's been several on the road, but
I figured you'd
chicken have snakes and black snakes mainly.
Well, that's good though, isn't it?
It's really good. I don't bother either.
They still make me jump.
I've got two big black snakes and a couple of big chicken snakes I see, you know, working around the garden, mowing and stuff like that. So I give them their range. You know, I think they keep all those rattlers off of White Oak Mountain and Copperhead, all them creeks and wetland there, keep them run off.
Yeah, that's good, because they'll eat a copperhead or a rattlesnake.
Yeah, they sure do.
And mice, and of course they will get chickens too. But
yeah, before my daddy died, there was a big maple tree in his front yard, and of course he was disabled, you know, to farm anymore, so he spent a lot of time sitting in the front yard, and he had this chicken snake every spring that came and got up in that maple tree, and it took care of all the starling eggs. You know, the starlings would he would get aggravated because they'd mess on his chairs and stuff, you know, out of the limbs. And so I was cutting hay behind his house there one day, and I was coming out the driveway, and he managed to get up out that chair and flag me down. He said, "Don't run over my snake." So he was preserving that chicken snake because it did some good for him.
One thing I've learned about the snake, and I don't really have any scientific research or proof with me today, but we actually live near the interstate, and I've read some accounts of the vibration from that interstate has caused some of those reptiles and serpents to move some. So what used to be a little copperhead ridge there near my house, I haven't seen a copperhead in a long time.
I know that. Growing up, they said if you wanted to go and get snakes, is take a chainsaw, crank it up, and lay it on the ground, and that you would start seeing snakes eventually. I don't know. So there's something about vibration there. Or take something and take a stake and drive it in the ground and start sawing on the top of it.
Worms
to do that, yeah.
Yeah, worms do it real.
Yeah.
But I guess the most copperheads I ever saw, it was the Zaggy farm that they bought for Industrial Park, you know. And
Robert Alexander Zaggy the first or second.
Yeah, that's...
Because the one I went to school with was Robert Alexander Zaggy the third, or Zan, we called him.
Yeah, well, his dad, you know, bought that from his relative. So when I was 18 years old, under 18, I would go up and help him because he bought that and he wanted to clear it and sow it down. And that was the worst farm in the whole McDonald area that had copperhead snakes. That ditch that run down from the interstate down through the middle of that farm, the first year that I helped him up there, and he put up hay, and we cut that hay on that ditch. They were just copperheads all up and down that ditch. Mm-hmm. And those things, when you disturb them, you can smell them too. I mean, they do have odor. They put off odor.
Mm-hmm. That skunk I caught behind my house had some odor too.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, I got two this year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, since the construction is going on at Exit 20, we have seen a fox.
We live across the interstate from that, and we're
we've
seeing
had turkey in our yard bobcat. This week, and a bobcat, and we've had coyotes, and, you know, all those animals have been displaced.
Yeah, they've been.
Kenneth and I took a little tour on the way in this morning, and there was three or four different locations there where we encountered white-tailed deer crossing the road, and another area there was some turkey running around. So this morning was a good morning.
We've seen a lot of turkey. Of course, they've cut all that ridge out over there right at exit 20, and they've come across APD 40, and like I say, I've seen more turkey. I've seen I haven't seen the bobcat. Seen when it snowed, I've seen where the bobcat come through. Right. You know, and and then we've seen foxes, and unfortunately seen the skunks. And I was trying to catch the groundhog that dug under my big room, and I set a cage out there and put all the stuff in there. Next morning, come up and there's a skunk in it. You know, and skunks are harder to get out of the cage than the
absolutely.
And then of course, you know. Folks, if you catch a skunk or anything, it's against the law to take your cage and drop it off on somebody else's property. Once you catch it,
it's yours.
It's yours, and you probably have to eliminate the animal or release it. And on a skunk's case, you just have to sort of. And PDAP told me how to move the cage. And I said, I don't believe you, PDAP. I need an example.
Yes, correct.
And so, but I've got groundhog and two skunks this year. So
we have a lot of raccoons in our area also.
Yeah.
You're apt to catch one of those when you set your.
I haven't seen it. Of course, if you see raccoons in the daytime, usually they're sick. They're usually a nighttime animal.
Yeah, well, we figure those are the culprits that can open our trash cans.
Absolutely. They'll take the lid right off.
They're a smart animal, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. They are smart.
And they will bite. I don't care how cute you think those things are, they will bite you.
We had stray cats in our. At our house, and I flipped on the front porch light one night to see a skunk eating out of the cat bowl, and the cat's up on the chair
watching
from a distance. I just turned the light back
that's
off.
That's not a good place to have a skunk is on your front porch.
Absolutely.
So what other animals do you see down
coyote.
In the
do you have any coyote?
I've seen one.
Yeah. Usually the coyote, where you have coyote, you don't have the gray fox or you don't have groundhogs because that's one of their.
This guy was just kind of passing through. He looked like he was just.
Yeah, it was a little taller too. You know, they say that the coyotes we have here. I went through a wildlife class just recently, and they were saying that that they may have interbred some with foxes. I mean, with wolves.
Yeah, wolf. Yeah.
And so they're a little bit bigger.
They are.
I was talking to lay down in Monroe County not too long ago.
They can handle a gray fox easily. I mean,
We found a gray fox dead in our backyard, but it died with the distemper, I think. And then we had a gray fox had three kits underneath my mom's house.
Mm.
So the groundhogs were in there. So, but I think the fox took over there.
Yeah.
And so we've had problems with groundhogs. I live there 40-something years now and never seen a groundhog in the area. Now I'm getting them.
Since the coyote are getting so populated in our areas, what's going on, excuse me, they are driving all these animals. These animals are learning that they can survive around your home or near your home because the coyote is not going to come as close. You know, in some of the bigger cities, Colorado and out in Colorado, you know, they come to people's yards and do things out there, but they've not got that bad here.
Armadillos are coming this way, too.
Yeah.
Go ahead, caller. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Hey, Ron.
Yeah.
I call it a wolf dog out there at Fort Hill Cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
He will not let you get near him, but he'll sit there and stare at you.
That's kind of how coyotes will do too. They'll stay just far enough away you can't.
It's probably a good thing he don't get closer to you.
Well, you watch him
right up there where my son and husband's buried, and I can be standing there at their grave, but he won't come close to me.
Now I haven't seen any up there, but it may be that you're going in the time of day that they're coming out.
And
I'm sort of scared of him, Daddy.
Well, I don't ever if you turn your back on those animals, you know, they're very smart. They will attack you when you turn. If you ever got a pack of dogs around you, mm-hmm. they will circle you and try to bite you in the back.
There's a couple of things you need to watch for when you're out in the cemeteries now are the groundhog holes and the ants. And you really have to be careful of those two things because they're all in all the cemeteries.
And turned over tombstones is a great place for a rattlesnake to hide.
Yes. Absolutely.
I don't want to do that.
No, me either. Bye, Anna.
Bye.
So, but you, what other animals? Do you have any beaver down that area?
Yes, we do have beaver.
See,
they're in our down in that spring area.
And, I thought they would.
And I've had to destroy some dams down there because they flooded the hay field and everything mm-hmm. over in the meadow part where the mineral spring is. Year before last, they had that water backed up so bad it was running down the middle of the field or hay wow. field.
They can cut a tree down with those teeth.
They can set trees out in that dam and they'll grow just like. You know, a willow tree, they'll just take a sprout or a limb and they'll put it down in that mud and hey, it'll just start growing and it'll never tear up. Yeah, they're a quite smart animal.
And now, what type of wood do they usually do?
They've got in our areas mostly just willow and Baltimore bushes and then they use all the grass along the creek line. They'll pull all that grass off and pack that into their dam and help secure
it's
the
water. It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah. When you tear it down, how long does it take to build it back?
Well,
They will.
I've had them, if I didn't take down a big enough area, they'll start that night and build it back. I mean, it'll actually be sticks and mud and grass.
Down in your, I'm sorry, I thought you were finished. Down in your communities, what houses are down in there that you think are early 1900s or before? Can you think of any?
Well, I'd say, you know, that house my mom and dad lived in, it's probably early 1900 house.
Early 1900 yeah. house, probably. What about you, Dole?
I was thinking there a while ago, I think that Roe Mines may have built that house and that barn. Okay. I believe it was a Roe Mines. John Roe Mines. Yeah.
What about the Trotter house?
That house is probably as old as our farmhouse or older. Yeah, it's in the early 1900s, mm-hmm. two-story house. Mm-hmm. And they've got it in really good shape. And of course, my sister.
Now, where is it?
It's on Bancroft Road.
Bancroft Road.
Yeah. Okay. Ball Springs and Bancroft, the little Ball Springs Road mm-hmm. where it goes across.
Y'all know where Morrow had a horse barn?
No.
Cliff Morrow had a...
Well, I've got
deceased now, but anyway, it's right across the
road. Yeah.
If I can quit racing long enough, I've got homework for you two fellas. I need, and everyone listening, again, I'm going to try to do this house book. I'd like to come out and take pictures of houses that are still standing that are early 1900s and before, and maybe have an old family picture with the house.
We want a current picture, then an old picture, and then write about the history of the house.
And and I mean, if all I know is that it was built by John Romaines, that's good enough because it's going to be more of a picture book than anything else. So we've mentioned this before, and everybody got really excited, and then I started racing and got too busy. But I'd really like to work on that this summer, although we've already got another documentary.
In the works. you know, some people build race cars. We make movies. And,
yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You know, we haven't got any Oscars yet or anything. Yeah. You know, but
now we've gotten some pretty nice.
You got to start out. So.
You got to start somewhere.
You know, our film aren't going to be the best Hollywood thing, but it's going to tell you some good stories. That's just fun. You know, you've seen the documentary. It was just pretty professional. All original music and, you know.
We think that we're going to, we've got our eyes on Copper Hill right now to do something about the families and the mining and the communities up there.
There's been one little documentary about it, but it was done by the companies up there. And, of course, that's a different story than what the people may tell and, you know, in their history. And soon there won't be any miners left. The people actually went down in the ground.
Yeah, there's a lot of
them. We understand that. Yeah, see, all that's left, the people from the 80s.
That's right.
And so all the old miners are gone, but the stories are still in the families. And a lot of them still live in the company houses. And a lot of them have pictures of what a bustling town Copper Hill and Ducktown used to be and the train depots. And so We're working with the museum up there. We're going to help the museum put something together, and so you've got something to look forward to.
Well, you know, this all this construction down on the south end, it starts all the way from almost Bancroft Road all the way up to APD 40. Now, have you seen any effect of the water or anything since all this construction? I know they've talked about Brimer Creek. Some
oh, he just grinned.
You know, is it a problem or a concern? Or?
Well, it's definitely a concern with a couple of people in that area. They've not been there as long as I have. There hasn't anybody seen no muddier water come down Brimer Creek than I have, because we used to get in that water up at the bridge at Brimer Creek Bridge there, and when it'd come a flood and we'd get in that water, we'd swim all the way down. We'd swim half a mile down to the Carson farm. And when we get out, we'd be muddy, you know. But I understand, you know, like since they're no-till farming there at the house and sometimes plowing it up, you get a little more color in the water. But I don't think it's any worse than when I was growing up, you know, as a kid, because it got just as muddy. And there's definitely no kind of chemicals other than maybe just some weed killer might get in. But it's pretty good ways. Those fields have to run a long ways to get down in Brimer Creek. But I don't think there's any toxins or anything in that creek.
Well, you know, with all the chemicals that people used to put on fields and now illegal, you know, there are a lot of stuff in the water anyway.
But
the springs are furnishing so much fresh water in there constantly, you know, although it's a little muddy, it's still probably good.
But I'm glad somebody's concerned and they're keeping their eyeball on
you
it.
Have,
that's right.
Now, do you have turtle and fish in those creeks or...
Yeah, there's fish, you know, little red eye bass, brim, bluegill,
suckers.
Yeah, suckers, crawfish, a lot of crawfish. So you know, that's a sign that it's a pretty clean creek when you have crawfish and stuff.
When the wildlife is still
there.
Good morning, live on Old Town Cleveland.
Yes, I heard him mention John Romines.
Yes.
Now, where we live, my husband's John Romines, and we live in McDonald. And he understood when he bought that land that a John Romines had lived there. The house is gone now. But do they know anything? I understood you say that it was a house that was standing?
The house, when my father and them moved to McDonald, the house was already there, the barn was already there, and I just heard my parents mention John. It may be another John Romines.
Well,
there was also a Dr. Mahoney right where I have my house on Roark Lane. A Dr. Mahoney had a house right there. When I dug the foundation for my house, I dug up some old homemade brick where my garage is. So there it was, a lot of housing stuff that I don't know about because I'm just not that old yet.
This is right on Lee Highway. South Lee Highway.
And it's really
a neat thing because my husband did not know that a John Romines had lived there.
Well, I'm not going to say he lived there. All I know is I thought I heard him mention that he may have do you know if he was a carpenter or anything back in those days? He might have built it. He might have been a carpenter or something.
He was one of my husband's distant ancestors, and so it was really neat.
To hear that name pop up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where the house was, but now there was a guy came from out of state.
Yeah.
And told us that his grandpa or great-grandpa had lived there, and he wanted to know if it was okay to make pictures, and we told him sure. He got across the highway.
Yeah.
Made pictures of our home, but do you know if anyone has a picture of that old house? Because the one that we were told, of course, it's not there now. Our house is there.
Yeah. What part of Lee Highway did you say it was on?
Well, it's right there before you get to the store. You know, as you turn down to go down McDonald Road?
Yeah.
It's right there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So if anybody has a picture of that house, I would like to.
Okay, well, if anybody does, they're listening right now. Yeah, they'll let me know.
They have a lot of people listening. And of course, I got an older sister. She's quite a few years older than I am. I'm the baby of the family, and she knows a lot. Some of these topics, I'm sure that she could cover real well. But I'm just too young to remember some of these houses, but I just remember my parents talking about maybe a John
too
Romine's.
Too young to remember those houses and too old to remember, too, right?
Well, this John Romine's came out of Sevier County. That's where Romine's came down from Sevier County into Bradley.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks for being a listener.
Thank you.
This is always like opening up a puzzle box, but we don't know what the pieces look like, and we don't know what the picture's going to look like when we get it put together.
The picture behind us right now is Louderback Resort. Do you remember it looking like that?
Halfway like that, I do. I remember it standing and that porch all the way around it.
Now, when did it actually close for actually doing business? Do you remember?
Was it already closed
when you was a boy, or...
It was already closed when I was a boy. When I visited my mom's uncle over there at the foot of it, it was already closed. He was just trying to protect the land and the structure. And he did it for nothing. I mean, he was just trying to preserve.
There was an old piano in there or something, I think.
Absolutely. I remember that old piano.
That's a shame that wasn't saved and put in the museum.
When I remember that piano, my mom's uncle, or Uncle Henry Pope was his name, mm-hmm. and he was quite old when I was young. He said some boys or some gang come up from the backside of that mountain and got into that old hotel and just destroyed the piano and everything one day. Just tore the whole insides out of it.
That's a shame.
Yeah, it's a terrible thing.
Well, glad that we got some pictures, and there was a lady from your community down there wrote a book. I can't remember what it was, a little
Miss
one.
Henry.
Yeah.
McDonald and the Everons.
Yeah,
that was
It's still in print. I believe the McDonald Ruitton Club sells those.
That's a good thing. They still got them, I think.
Well, let me ask you this question. When you guys were growing up, did you ever find any like Civil War artifacts in the community or Indian artifacts?
I have a little can that my dad had, and it has some old bullets and stuff from like maybe Civil War rifles and stuff like black powder. It's definitely black powder bullets. So I do have a few, and we find occasionally arrowheads and stuff like that on the farm, because Black Fox, which is not too far from us, that was a reservation over there, and they come over, I guess, that far hunting.
Well, anywhere
game.
That there was good water, smart people lived. And matter of fact, I found some paperwork from the 1830s talking about what would be Tucker Springs. The U.S. government having to pay the fellow that owned those for the mineral tubs. They were called vats or something, but basically it was big soaking tubs that were there at Tucker Springs.
We were down in Dawsonville, and we interviewed Freddie Fryer when he was inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And we done our interview of Freddie there. And I found out his grandmother and grandfather is from Alhalla.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So what was the name of the?
Well, they were from South Alhalla.
Yeah, on the south, which will be on south side of the interstate now.
Okay.
Yeah, near South Lee Highway.
Okay. So was that the Fryer family, Doyle, or was it a different name?
No, it was a Fryer family that lived in there.
Yeah. He remembers coming there, and he when he comes back to this area. I'm glad to know that you guys know where that is, because he wants to be taken there. Yeah, he was just a small child, and he would have no idea how to find it now, and he would just like to go stand and look at the land.
That is good. Go back where your grandfather lived, and where my grandfather is pretty well sold off now, but the house is still sitting there, and this property where they donated for the schools behind there. We have the deed where he donated the property.
Which happened in lots of, that's how all the communities.
Yeah.
All right, Doyle brought his lunch, or he brought something for show and tell. What'd you bring today, Doyle?
What I wanted to do is show you that I'm a master gardener. I've been listening and hearing all this stuff about master gardening. Well, I have two examples here today of some wild greens that people still eat. And there's
how many pieces here? Let me put it up to the camera.
There's two kinds of dock.
Okay.
There's a narrow dock. And that's an example of the narrow dock. That's one we would eat. There's also a broad dock. And this is really, in most cases, it's just considered a weed. But it's good to mix with poke, P-O-K-E.
Salad.
And we call it poke salad. I was looking in one of my reference books, and it just called it poke weed.
Oh.
But anyway,
I guess you call it weed if it's growing where you don't want it to grow. You call it salad if you want to eat
it. That's right.
Hey, we got a caller here.
But anyway.
We get this caller. Go ahead. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Doc Hollywood coming at you.
Hey, Doc Hollywood. How are you?
Hey, didn't mean to break the momentum of your show here near the end. But, hey, just want to get in a quick plug. I'm going to do something a little different tonight there on Whoop FM. About 6 o'clock, I'm going to debut my Saturday Night Fever show of disco dance music there on the Whoop FM.
A little disco music. So
yeah, due to scheduling complex, Ron, not been able to do many shows lately. So we're going to switch to the Saturday Night format here on some select Saturday nights here. We play the best 70s and 80s R&B, and of course, disco, my favorite. Of course, you know my show's been stopped and started a few times, and we won't get into all that, but there was a learning curve there, but looks like I've cleaned up my act, and the powers that be are pretty good with me right now.
Well, now, you've cleaned up your act?
For your guests there, but you won't tell them that my hair is down to my belt, and I still think I'm living in the 1980s, will you?
Well, I was going to, but you just did. Hey, Doc, if you're not working tomorrow, come up and see our documentary up at Walker Valley.
Of course, I know Deb called in the other night on Good Sports Thursday night there and did plug that. Thanks so much for you guys' tireless work and efforts in all things Whoop and documentary-wise and all that you do beyond Class Act. You guys bring class to the stage.
What time's your show tonight?
Going to kick it off at 6, go for an hour and a half there. Just depending on how the flow goes. Of course, going to catch that horse race today. Of course, Bad Actor will be watching.
Yeah, the Preakness is today at 6 on NBC.
And also, after you listen to your show, is it Dynamo? What is it called again?
Oh, man, the official title of it is Doc Hollywood's Dynamite Dance Show.
Dynamite Dance. You're not going to be dancing too, are you?
Well, yeah, for those of you looking on the World Wide Web at WOOPFM.com, I see you have several tuned in today there. You can see Doc slinging his hair around, and my solid gold dancer going to make her debut. She's imported. She's from Belgium.
Oh, wow.
Makes me look good on the dance.
So you done, all the American girls then figured you out, and you had to go out of the country, right?
That's exactly right, Ron. And send off from a mail order solid gold dancer. She's all right. Worth every penny of it.
And then after you listen to your show, if you want a little music, go out to B&B Marina tonight. And the Convertibles with our own Pro Daddy will be on there. And that starts at 9 o'clock up at the B&B Marina.
That's absolutely right. Rain or shine, I'm going to cross promote this show as well.
But, all righty. Thank you, Doc. Always good talking to you, buddy.
Okay,
have a good time. Bye-bye. All right, let's finish up with about the poke greens.
But anyway, we eat the poke and the naridoc, and what you do is you just cook it like you do your turnip greens, and you mix it with your turnip greens and mustard, and you can also put reddish tops in there and eat those. And some people chop a boiled egg up and mix it with it, and I like a little vinegar on mine, a little apple cider vinegar. Some people grease it a little bit, but I don't care too much for the grease on it.
Now, can you eat those raw?
A little margarine or a little butter, but
can you eat those raw? Can you eat it raw?
Anything that you can eat raw, you don't have to really cook a whole lot, but I think I want to cook that.
Okay.
I haven't really tried any of it.
I was just curious.
Go ahead, Dad.
No.
Let's see who this caller is. Go ahead, caller.
Hey, Ron.
Hey.
I know he's telling the truth because I used to pick that stuff.
Yeah. Well, now, for years, our neighbor would come across the yard and come to our house and knock on the door and ask permission to pick my poke salad, and I didn't even know I had poke salad.
Talking about that narrow dog.
Oh, the narrow dog.
The narrow dog.
Yep.
Hey, many people know what it is.
Well, I recognize the leaves.
I mow it.
But I have not eaten that, to my knowledge.
But I can remember picking it, and Mom would fix it with poke salad.
Mm-hmm. You just think it gives it an extra flavor, or they just need something else to fill up the pan?
I don't know. I think she's just trying to fill up the pot. But yeah. She would put eggs in. It tastes pretty good.
You know, that, what was it, Yule Gibbons, you say many parts of a pine tree is edible? So yeah. Apparently lots of your yard is edible, and, you know.
Yeah, that's right.
But I would have not picked this and ate it, Dole.
I had not heard nobody mention that in years.
Yep.
Well, say the name of it again.
That's Naradoc. N-O-C-K.
Naradoc.
I used to find that for the kids' leaf collections.
Yes. Do you eat this, too?
I've never eaten Naradoc, but I've had my share of poke salad.
I've had poke salad.
Yeah.
If I ate Naradoc, nobody told me. I ate Naradoc one time and had some catfish Naradoc.
In farming, that Naradoc was our enemy.
Yeah.
You know, we try to keep that stuff killed out because, you know, it has a very abundant root system, goes deep in the ground, and it just comes
messes
up.
Messes with your farming.
Do you have any ginseng on top of them?
Okay, bye.
Do you have any ginseng down there on those
Never
hills?
Found any ginseng.
I don't think the hills expensive. Around here are
very. Oh, yes.
I mean, it's.
Of course, it's against the law now, isn't it?
You have to be real careful about it, but usually it takes a little bit higher elevation.
It does. Like Crossville, a lot of it in Crossville.
And they have TV shows where people going in there stealing that stuff and making $1,700, $1,800 for a bag.
Yeah, boy, it used to work for me over when I run a textile plant. He did that night and day until they stopped it, you know, and passed the law.
Well, and see, some people know how to pick it, and it comes back, and then some people just go in there. And
now, you're talking about the watercress and all that. Now, is watercress just a lettuce type?
Yeah.
Grows in the creeks.
Yeah.
Round springs.
It's a water.
Yeah. Cooler water.
Cooler water. Cooler fresh water.
You got something you want to say about that stalk?
Another aspect of the poke is when it's younger. This is a little more mature. It's getting late in the growing season. Some people just take it and chop it up like okra and batter it and fry
cook
it.
Cook it just like okra.
Eat it. Mm-hmm. Cook it like okra.
On smelling it.
It don't smell like okra.
No, it doesn't.
Not as slimy.
But, you know, there is a story out that you can be poisoned with poke salad if it's not properly cooked.
Yeah.
But mostly I think it's because it gets too old.
Yeah, it's old in the season right now.
Yeah.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. It really is. It's better when you can pick it when it's just about that tall.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it's
the whole plant?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. It's just a young, tender sprout.
We used to have some in our flower bed, too.
Tender. Yeah. And the dog lot was a great place, you know.
Fertilizer.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Go ahead, caller.
Hey, this is R.D. I'm here at Harris Creek.
Yes, R.D.
Yeah, I'm enjoying this show. These good fellas you got in there around my neck of the woods. And I grew up eating poke salad. In fact, when I first moved here in '88, they used to have the Poke Salad Festival up on Walden's Ridge.
Yep.
Yeah.
I don't think they do anymore, but I actually made the newspaper, got my picture in the paper. The Poke Salad Festival one day, went out and picked a whole truckload, and it's a real cold year. But we grew up eating poke salad, and Grandma always told me you had to boil it two or three times, get it when it's young, boil it two or three times, fry some hog jowl. Crisp, and then pour out a lot of the grease and heat it up, slap that old wet. Now, I still cook it, but my wife won't let me cook it in the house. It'll stink up a house like nobody's been.
Yeah, well, this stock smells really strong.
I had some friends come down from Iowa. He was a doctor here, and I kept telling him about poke salad and how wherever the cows or the dogs went, it really grew very well. And so I picked him a big bag of it one time, took it over to the house, and stood there and wrote down how you cook it and all that stuff, and him and his wife sitting there looking at me like I was crazy.
When I was picking all that poke salad on a Dallas Bay, and park rangers come up and got a hold of me and said, "What is that green stuff you're hauling?" Well, good Lord, you know, it's like March. I said, "Hey, this is poke salad, you eat it." And they're like, "You don't smoke that?" And I'm like,
well, I guess you can. I don't know what it does, you know.
I wouldn't. So, but hey, I've been really enjoyed this show, and it's good hearing these guys over in my neck of the woods. I just wish I'd have been living and growing up in Bradley County. But I really enjoy your show.
You got here as fast as you could, did you?
Mom and Daddy moved down here now next door to me, and they love it here. They just
sounds good.
Well, we're glad you're here, too, and glad you listened to Old Town Cleveland.
Thanks for calling in.
Thank you.
What's rabbit tobacco?
It's rabbit tobacco. it grows up on a stalk or a stem.
Yeah.
And when it gets mature, it'll be a white, grayish color. And people used to pull it off.
Is it a weed or
it's a weed?
Okay. Because I remember hearing my dad talk about rabbit tobacco, and I'm thinking
unless you plant it, it's a weed.
It's a weed.
Yeah. Hey, go ahead, Collie.
Hey, Ron. Just wanted to let everybody know that tomorrow at 2:00, Bradley High football team's having a golf tournament at Chatham Valley Golf Course.
All right.
Football program. So. Like anyone that wants to play to come on out, and I'm sure Coach Flo would get them signed up.
Is this the trustee?
Well, it's one of them. Hey, another thing, I just want to brag. I'm enjoying listening, but let me brag on Doyle a little bit. Every time he's on there, I learn something. I learned from him when I was in school and a kid, and I keep learning from him. So he's got some stories and very informative, and I love listening to him when he's on your show.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
We enjoy having country boys on the show.
Well, that's good. And the other thing, I'm glad Doc Hollywood called him because – I'm not mistaken, I've seen Doyle out on the disco floor in the past.
That was him.
I'm sure he'll be listening.
He was smoking rabbit tobacco.
Hey, good show.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, bye-bye. Yeah, I'm sure our audience is one of those disco-type audience. I know Ken's saying, can I get it on the internet?
Ron, I have one more thing. We didn't get into cooking and preserving and
we
so
may have
forth
to do that another
today.
Show but
we
come
might
tell
be
us
able
what
do
you
that
want
another day. Yeah. But I brought with me a copy of Mother's bread and butter pickles.
Ooh.
Oh yeah,
and people loved her bread and butter pickles, so I'm gonna leave this with Debbie.
Well,
and
I'll try that recipe.
Practice. Yeah.
My cucumber plants have blooms on them, so soon I'll be.
Yeah. Well, I just tell everybody there's one thing that's not on that piece of paper, and everybody will have to develop their own, so that's just a personal touch.
All right.
She had a personal touch. And, knew
you know, it's just so hard to know that moment when you could stop cooking them.
Yeah.
So they don't get soggy.
Go ahead, caller.
I don't know, but I heard that Doyle and Kenneth ate so much boiled okra and folks say that when they were kids, they couldn't hold their socks up. And they had to wear a cold old rag around the ankle to keep the cut worms from getting them.
You're probably correct.
Yeah.
That cold oil would help on those chiggers too, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Boy.
Did you ever have to pick blackberries?
Oh, yeah.
My grandma made me pick the blackberries.
I don't know who that was, but I enjoyed that.
Doyle McCracken. Oh.
You know exactly.
They recognize
it. I think it was.
Yeah, those blackberry picking, and I come back just. And those chickens get places you don't want chickens.
Yeah, you got that right.
Okay.
For days.
That's right.
Hey, we've spent this 2 hours and going into overtime here. Thank you so much for being here today.
Final word?
Anything you
well,
like
I just
say?
Enjoyed being here with y'all today, and I sort of dreading it when I come since it's the first time I've been on here, but I've enjoyed it. And
well, we
hope I hadn't told too many stories. Untrue.
I love it.
You know, you can't tell enough on Old Town Cleveland, and we hope you come back, Doyle.
Oh, I enjoyed it, and there was one thing I wanted to mention, and maybe I have time. I didn't do justice to George McKenzie and Roy Ragsdale when I was on here previously talking about Dixie Youth Baseball, which was a volunteer program, and those two fellas spent literally hundreds and hundreds of hours volunteering and helping our youth baseball program years ago.
Well, thank you, and good people, too. I'm very good friends with those in fact.
Don't forget, tomorrow afternoon, 3:00, Walker Valley High School, we're having a free showing of the documentary. Everybody come out. It's going to be a good time.
Yeah, and then if you've seen it once, come back and see it again. I think the crowd, watching it in the crowd is so much fun, you know. And
if you don't make it out and you'd like to buy a copy of the DVD, go over and see our good friend Victor at Central City Auto Parts. He says he occasionally sells some auto parts now, but he mostly sells DVDs.
That's great.
Yeah. Well, it's great for us. I mean, that's a place that everybody knows where it's at, they can go there and pick one up.
We tell people every week that you've got to take time to get those old pictures from out of the drawers and out of the closet and the shoe boxes. Get someone in your family, the oldest member of your family, to help you name who that is. Get you some, buy you some white stickers, write it on there, put it on the back of the picture, because when those older relatives are gone, we won't know who those people are. We've lost history. And then share those photos. You know, there's ways of doing that now, because you'll be surprised what a picture of your grandfather will bring back memories of his neighbors and their children, and the people you grew up with. You see those things, the old businesses they ran. You have to save that history, or it's going to be gone. That's what we try to do here on Old Town Cleveland. Talking about everything we talked about today is just the type of things we want to save as history. And Deb, we always say we'll always remember about Pearl Harbor, but
will we remember Aunt Pearl?
Oh, who knows?
See you guys next week.
We'll see you here.
We'll have the circuit preacher wives on, or someone talking about them. Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye.
Where'd the old town go? They moved it on over here in the shopping mall.
You are listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
You need money overnight? Check in.